Recorded Books and One-Click Digital present American Mirror, The Life and Art of Norman Rockwell by Deborah Solomon, narrated by Andrea Gallo and directed by John Sood.
Introduction. Welcome to Rockwell Land. I didn't grow up with a Norman Rockwell poster hanging in my bedroom. I grew up gazing at a Helen Frankenthaler poster with bright, runny rivulets of orange and yellow bordering a rectangle whose center remained daringly blank. As an art history major, and later as an art critic, I was among a generation that was taught to think of modern art as a kind of luminous, cleanly swept room. Abstract painting, our professors said, jettisoned the accumulated clutter of 500 years of subject matter, from languid Madonnas and racked saints to tabletops laden with curvy fruit, in an attempt to reduce art to pure form. Rockwell? Oh, God. He was viewed as a cornball and a square, a convenient symbol of the bourgeois values modernism sought to topple. His long career overlapped with the key art movements of the 20th century, from cubism to minimalism. But while most avant-gardists were heading down a one-way street toward formal reduction, Rockwell was driving in the opposite direction. He was putting stuff into art. His paintings have human figures and storytelling, snoozing mutts, grandmothers, clear-skinned Boy Scouts, and wood-paneled station wagons. They have policemen, attics, and floral wallpaper. Moreover, most of them began life as covers for the Saturday Evening Post, a weekly general interest magazine that paid Rockwell for his work, and paychecks, frankly, were another modernist no-no. Real artists were supposed to live hand-to-mouth, preferably in walk-up apartments in Greenwich Village. The scathing condescension directed at Rockwell during his lifetime eventually made him a prime candidate for revisionist therapy, which is to say, an art world hug. He received one posthumously in the fall of 2001, when Robert Rosenblum, the brilliant Picasso scholar and art world contrarian-in-chief, presided over a Rockwell exhibition at the Solomon R. Guggenheim Museum in New York. It represented a historic collision between mass taste and museum taste, filling the pristine spiral of the Goog with Rockwell's plebeian characters. The barefoot country boys and skinny geezers with sunken cheeks and Rosie the Riveter sitting triumphantly on a crate, savoring her white bread sandwich. I first wrote about Rockwell in 1999 in an article for the New York Times Magazine. The day after it was published, Jarvis Rockwell, an artist himself, called me up out of the blue and mentioned that a serious biography of his father remained to be written. I'd written biographies of Jackson Pollock and Joseph Cornell, members of the American avant-garde, whose work embodied the romance of New York Bohemia at mid-century. I decided to write this book because I was curious about the part of American culture that didn't unfurl in Greenwich Village or represent the counterculture, about the part that lies beyond, some would say beneath, the official story of art. To be sure, the basic outlines of his life have been visible at least since 1960, when, with the help of his writer son, Thomas Rockwell, he published his autobiography, My Adventures as an Illustrator. Through no fault of Tom's, who assembled the book from a series of anecdotes his father recorded on a dictaphone, the omissions are fairly enormous. Although Rockwell offers lengthy descriptions of his Navy buddies and his acquaintances at a New York boarding house, such as the pseudonymous middle-aged women who came to meals in their bathrobes and hairnets and never failed to raise hell about specks of dirt on the silverware. He barely mentions his marriages, his politics, his psychiatrists, or his constant treks to Southern California. He forgets to mention when people close to him, including his wives, die. And, perhaps out of modesty, he doesn't see fit to discuss the meaning of his work. The great subject of his work was American life, not the frontier version with its questing for freedom and romance, but a homelier version steeped in the we the people, communitarian ideals of America's founding in the 18th century. The people in his paintings are related less by blood than by their participation in civic rituals, from voting on election day to sipping a soda at a drugstore counter. Doctors spend time with patients, whether or not they have health insurance. Students appreciate their teachers and remember their birthdays. Citizens at town hall meetings stand up and speak their mind without getting booed or shouted down by gun-toting rageaholics. This is America before the fall, or at least before searing divisions in our government and general population shattered any semblance of national solidarity. Which isn't to suggest that Rockwell was a man with an overtly political agenda, a Thomas Jefferson with a paintbrush, contriving to improve the character of our national life. His political sensibility was elusive and lay dormant for decades. He first registered to vote in 1926 with the Republican Party. It was the era of Calvin Coolidge, who is linked to only one famous comment, "The business of America is business." In those days, the Republican Party stood for moderation. This heightens the poignancy of Rockwell's transformation, decades later, into a man who championed nuclear disarmament, voted for Lyndon Johnson for president, and produced the single most memorable painting to emerge from the civil rights movement. Who was Norman Rockwell? A lean, bluish man with a Dunhill pipe, his features arranged into a gentle mask of neighborliness. He went on television talk shows and came across as sane and personable, a Cracker Barrel philosopher in a tweedy jacket and bow tie, chuckling heartily, the famous pipe jutting. But behind the mask lay anxiety and fear of his anxiety. On most days, he felt lonesome and loveless. His relationships with his parents, wives, and three sons were uneasy, sometimes to the point of estrangement. He eschewed organized activity. He declined to go to church. For decades, he had a lucrative gig providing an annual painting for the Boy Scouts calendar, but he didn't serve as a troop leader or have his own children join the Scouts. He was more than a bit obsessive, a finicky eater whose preferred dessert was vanilla ice cream. He once made headlines by decrying the culinary fashion for parsley. He wore his shoes too small. Phobic about dirt and germs, he cleaned his studio several times a day. He washed his brushes and even the surfaces of his paintings with ivory soap. As he grew older, it occurred to him that he was spending a greater proportion of his time cleaning up and a diminishing proportion of time at his easel. He joked that one day he would only clean up. At age 59, he entered therapy with Erik Erikson, a celebrated psychoanalyst and German intellectual who came to this country as a refugee from the Nazis. Erikson, who coined the phrase identity crisis, and had been an artist in his wandering youth, met Rockwell after he joined the staff of the Austen Riggs Center in Stockbridge, Massachusetts. Finally, Rockwell found someone in whom he could confide his feelings of inadequacy and despondency, who could normalize them and allow him to become more direct and emotional in his art. Underlying Rockwell's every painting and gesture was his faith in the redemptive power of storytelling. Stories, he believed, were a buffer against despair and emptiness. Each of his post covers amounts to a one-frame story, complete with a protagonist and plot. Among his earliest inspirations was Charles Dickens, who taught him how to espy stories on every street corner. In some ways, Rockwell's paintings, which are grounded in the rendering of particulars, demand to be read like a story. The experience they offer is literary as much as it is visual, in the sense that he cared less about the sensual dazzle of oil paint than the construction of a seamless narrative. The public that saw and appreciated his paintings walked away from them thinking not about the dominance of cerulean blue or cadmium yellow, but about the kid on the 20-foot-high diving board up in the sky, terrified as he peers over the edge and realizes there's only one way down. Which isn't to diminish Rockwell as an oil-on-canvas painter. He was a master technician. In the heyday of abstract expressionism, when artists dripped and spattered pigment and took pleasure in the dramatic, death-defying sweep of an extra-large brush, Rockwell favored tiny paintbrushes and punctilious craftsmanship. He would knock himself out trying to conjure the texture of a brick wall or a wicker basket, transporting the objects of this world into the world of painting with an attention to detail that can be viewed as masterful or neurotic. He had the misfortune to come of age at a time when realist painting was written off as less authentic than abstract painting. Critics denounced him as insufficiently angst-ridden and overly cheery. What somehow got lost in the critical discussion is this: looking is an act of passion if you look hard enough. It probably didn't help that Rockwell was all too willing to make light of his work. The performer in him relished invitations to speak, be it in front of 12 parents at a monthly PTA meeting, a class of students at the Otis Art Institute in California, or a convocation of the National Press Club in Washington. His voice, a deep baritone, was as resonant as a radio announcer's. His modesty was legendary. He had the largeness of spirit to pretend that he had no largeness at all. It was hard to stay in awe of him because he was so little in awe of himself, recalled Kai T. Erikson, a sociologist and the son of Rockwell's therapist. He liked jokes less than he liked humorous stories, but he wasn't joke-averse. In January 1955, he jotted down a joke he'd heard and sent it to his wife's therapist, Dr. Robert P. Knight. Here it is. A man flies back from an African safari for the express purpose of asking his psychiatrist two questions. The psychiatrist scoffs at his abruptness, but allows the man to pose the two questions. The man asks, "Is it possible for a man to fall in love with an elephant?" The psychiatrist assures him, "No, it's not possible." Then the man asks, "Well, the second question is, do you know anyone who wants to buy a large engagement ring?" At the risk of overinterpretation, you can read the joke as a story about a man in love with an overly large object, a joke about impossible love. It acknowledges that intense feelings can flourish outside of socially sanctioned relationships in the wilderness of the self. Recently, I came across a reference in a newspaper story to the kind of family tranquility Norman Rockwell depicted in his paintings. It's one of the many fallacies surrounding his art. Rockwell was not, in any sense, a painter of families. To the contrary, his work demonstrates how easy it is to opt out of the model nuclear family and find pleasure in alternate attachments. Of Rockwell's 323 covers for the Saturday Evening Post, only three portray a conventional family of parents and two or more children: Coming and Going of 1947, Walking to Church of 1953, and Easter Morning of 1959. Not a single cover shows a mother alone with a daughter or a son. There are no fathers providing advice to daughters. Instead, Rockwell culled the majority of his figures from an imaginary assembly of boys and fathers and grandfathers who convene in places where women seldom intrude. Boyishness is presented in his work as a desirable quality, even in girls. Rockwell's female figures tend to break from traditional gender roles and assume masculine guises. Typically, a red-headed girl with a black eye sits in the hall outside the principal's office, grinning despite the reprimand awaiting her. It's not a coincidence that Rockwell kept returning to the world of boyhood in his art. As a child, he had to play second fiddle to his older brother Jarvis, a boy's boy, an athlete with fearsome confidence. Norman, by contrast, was a 99-pound weakling, forever disappointed with his body and given to resentment. Growing up in an era when boys were still judged largely by their body type and prowess at sports, he felt, as he once wrote, like a lump, a long, skinny nothing, a beanpole without the beans. He was always seeking, it seemed, the protecting wing of a brother. Even after he became famous, he required the nearly constant companionship of men whom he perceived as physically strong. He sought out friends who went fishing in the wilderness and trekked up mountains, men with mud on their shoes, daredevils who weren't prim and careful the way he was. Although he married three times and raised a family, he acknowledged that he didn't pine for women. They made him feel imperiled. He was a man of extreme dependencies and complicated proclivities. He was given to affections that don't fit any known label, and his life wasn't made any easier by having been lived in an era when a man was expected to share his life with what used to be called a swell girl. What's interesting is how Rockwell's personal desire for inclusion and normalcy spoke to the national desire for inclusion and normalcy. In the early 20th century, immigrants pouring into this country were eager to become American citizens and assume the trappings of national identity. But what does an American look like? On the surface, there was little to connect the farmer roping a cow in Oklahoma to the Polish-Jewish tailor eking out a living in the Bronx to the Spanish-speaking bodega owner in California. Unlike most other countries, America was made up of hundreds of ethnic and local subcultures. Because it lacked homogeneous, universally shared traditions, it had to invent some. So it came up with Thanksgiving, baseball, and Norman Rockwell. When Rockwell published his first cover for the Saturday Evening Post in 1916, there was no radio, television, or internet, and the Post was the national frame of reference. As the largest circulation magazine in the country, it helped spawn a new kind of culture, mass culture. Millions of Americans who loved Rockwell's work never saw an original painting of his. Instead, they sat at their kitchen tables poring over the latest issue of the Saturday Evening Post and reading his images, a number of which, by the way, portrayed people who themselves were engaged in the act of reading or trying to decipher messages on paper. For instance, a boy studies a lunch bill in a railroad dining car, trying to calculate the tip. two cleaning women lean into each other in an empty theater, reading a playbill that someone better off left behind. A handsome, long-limbed grocery clerk spends his lunch break engrossed in a law book as the face of Abraham Lincoln, a former grocer, hovers beneficently from two tacked-up photographs on the wall behind him. Where do all these scenes take place? Nowhere you could drive to. Nowhere on a map. Rather, Rockwell Land is its own universe, freestanding and totally distinct. It can put you in mind of the invented terrain of Thornton Wilder's Our Town, which is set in the made-up town of Grover's Corners in New Hampshire, or Frank Capra's film It's a Wonderful Life, which is set in made-up Bedford Falls in upstate New York. Although Rockwell's paintings are presumed to portray smallish towns in New England, he rarely clues you in on the location, in part because the Saturday Evening Post was trying to appeal to readers across the country. Rockwell invented the small town that is located nowhere in particular. The small town that's large enough to encompass the entire population of the United States. The title of this book, American Mirror, is not meant to suggest that Rockwell held a mirror up to American life and painted a literal, mimetic version of it. Rather, his work mirrors his own temperament, his sense of humor, his fear of depths, and struck Americans as a truer version of themselves than the sallow, solemn, hard-bitten Puritans they knew from 18th-century portraits. When you gaze into a mirror, the writer Anne Hollander notes, you're imagining rather than seeing. Mirrors, she writes, are a means for creating satisfactory artistic fictions. Interestingly, at least a dozen of Rockwell's paintings feature people studying their faces in mirrors, including his famous triple self-portrait, which captures the comedy of trying to capture yourself. Did Rockwell have his limitations? Of course. As his critics are quick to point out, he turned his back on modernism and remained a happiness maximizer. Where, in his work, are disease and death? Where is his sense of existential dread? I would argue that angst is probably overrepresented in modern art. Surely we can make room for an artist who is more interested in running toward the light. Unlike his fellow realist Edward Hopper, whose work abounds with the long shadows of late afternoon, Rockwell prefers the light of morning. His work can put you in mind of that sunny, hopeful moment right before lunch. Though ridiculed by art critics and literary critics for much of his life, Rockwell commanded respect among painters and sculptors across the stylistic spectrum. Willem de Kooning openly expressed his adulation for him. Andy Warhol bought two of his paintings. Much about Rockwell's approach to art, the storytelling, the jokiness, the staged scenes and costumes, the reliance on photography, is standard practice among artists today. You cannot make a modern artist out of Rockwell, but you can make a postmodern artist out of him. He shares with the current generation a historically self-conscious approach to picture making. In interviews, Rockwell always declined to describe himself as an artist of any sort. When asked, he would invariably demur, insisting he was an illustrator. You can see the comment as a display of humility, or you can see it as a defensive feint. He couldn't be rejected by the art world if he rejected it first. But I think he meant the claim literally. While many 20th century illustrators thought of commercial art as something you did to support a second, little paying career as a fine artist, Rockwell didn't have a separate career as a fine artist. He only had the commercial part, the illustrations for magazines and calendars and advertisements. He didn't make pictures to show in galleries or to sell to collectors. When he parted with one of his paintings, it was often as a gift to a friend or neighbor. Surely he would be incredulous at the prices his pictures go for these days. In 2002, burnished by its appearance in the Guggenheim show, Rosie the Riveter was sold at Sotheby's for $4.9 million. In 2006, Breaking Home Ties was auctioned off for three times as much, $15.4 million, which remains the record price for a Rockwell. Prices from private sales might be higher, but are never disclosed. One mentions this reluctantly, for prices mislead. Prices are merely decorative stickers attached to works of art, not an expression of their essence. High prices indicate that an object is fashionable, that collectors clutch at it, whether brilliantly or blindly. By now, it seems a bit redundant to ask whether Rockwell's pictures are art. Most of us no longer believe that an invisible red velvet rope separates museum art from illustration. No one could reasonably argue that every abstract painting in a museum collection is aesthetically superior to Rockwell's illustrations, as if illustration were a lower, unevolved life form without the intelligence of the more prestigious mediums. The truth is that every genre produces its share of marvels and masterpieces, works that endure from one generation to the next, inviting attempts at explication and defeating them in short order. Rockwell's work has manifested far more staying power than that of countless abstract painters who were hailed in his lifetime, and one suspects it is here for the ages. Chapter 1. The Birdman of Yonkers, 1830 to 1888. For every Rembrandt, for every artist whose work shines across the divide of centuries, there are thousands of artists whose names have been forgotten. Their work remains invisible to us, shuttered away in moldering basements and junk shops where no one has bothered to dust it off and look at it for decades. It's not a tragedy. It's simply the law of the art jungle. Lesser artists fall into obscurity over time. And then there's even a lower category, those who never had the good fortune to climb to a respectable professional height from which to plummet. Such an artist was Howard Hill, who endured most every disappointment that can attend the artistic life. Today, you won't find his paintings in any museums, and he isn't mentioned in any books on American art. This isn't entirely unjust. An intense, wounded man with a drinking problem, he was too overwhelmed by the demands of daily living to sustain the discipline needed for art. He died a pauper in 1888 and is buried in Yonkers, New York, in an unmarked grave. Hill was Norman Rockwell's maternal grandfather. He died 6 years before Rockwell was born. Yet, an absence can be more vivid than a presence, and Hill would exert a large influence on his grandson. As Rockwell grew up, he had ample opportunity to look at any number of Hill's paintings that were hanging in his home or in those of his relatives, and to hear his mother recall the flamboyant life that had produced them. Born in London in 1830, Hill spent most of his career as an artist emigre in Yonkers, New York, painting pictures of animals. Not elegant English animals, like the Queen's Spaniels or the glossy-haired horses of George Stubbs. Rather, He was fascinated by barnyard birds of the scruffiest sort, ducks and grouses and quail, even roosters and chickens. He might portray a mother quail with a covey of little chicks standing in tall grass at the edge of the woods, a meadow and sky unfurling in the distance. Bird painting, let's call it, occupied its own tiny niche in the market for landscapes that had been opened up by the painters of the Hudson River School, which, of course, was not a school but the first ever bona fide art movement in America. Was Hill a neglected master? Hardly. Rockwell, for one, referred to his pictures as potboilers. But as a child who was gifted at drawing and uncommonly observant, he took note of certain similarities between his work and that of his grandfather. Hill, he saw, drew with care and loaded up his pictures with minute detail. Perhaps Rockwell had inherited Hill's precisionist way with a pencil, or perhaps he had consciously appropriated it. I'm sure all the detail in my grandfather's pictures had something to do with the way I've always painted, he once noted. Right from the beginning, I always strived to capture everything I saw as completely as possible. In his later years, when Rockwell was 73 and working out of a barn-turned-studio in Stockbridge, Massachusetts, he was informed that one of his grandfather's bird paintings, Game, Bird, and Family, was coming up for auction at Park Burnett in New York. Although he wasn't a sentimental person and, in fact, could be callous with relatives, he called the auction house and then confirmed in a letter, "As you advised, I'm willing to make a bid of $250, and more if necessary, because I want to get the picture." He wound up paying $350. Who's to say why one realist painter lives and dies in unrelieved obscurity while another enjoys the opposite fate, that is, rises out of nowhere to become wealthy and famous and is invited to dine with the president at the White House? This isn't a question that Rockwell was likely to contemplate. He wasn't inclined to look back. He was one of the most efficient artists who ever lived. He never wasted a day. Is it possible to make art without risking failure? He would find a way. This, too, was part of his inheritance from Hill, whose fate alerted him to the hazards of artistic life. This story begins in London on July 16, 1851, a Wednesday. That was the day on which Hill married a young dressmaker. Her name was Anne Patmore, and she was the daughter of a servant. She'd just turned 22. He was slightly younger. At the time, he was living with his parents at 10 Smith Street in a dingy brick house in Chelsea. On the marriage certificate, Hill listed himself as artist. His father had to sign the document as well and gave his occupation as house decorator, which at the time referred to a tradesman who knew how to hang wallpaper and paint wood. Painters in London weren't a homogeneous group. A hierarchy ruled. The ship painter was rated below the house painter, who in turn was rated below the sign painter. The mural painter and easel painters were at the top of the heap. In describing himself as an artist, Hill was referring, perhaps, less to his achievements than his plan for the future. He didn't intend to wind up painting houses like his father. In the 7 years following their marriage, Howard and Anne remained in Chelsea, and three children were born, Susan Anne, Thomas, and Amy Eliza. During that time, Hill's career had its ups and downs, and probably more of the latter. When their first child was baptized, Hill and his wife were living on Jubilee Place, and he listed his trade as decorator as if momentarily knocked off his perch. When their second child was baptized, he was back up to the status of artist. And when their third child was born, they didn't bother having her baptized, perhaps because they were in the process of packing up their meager possessions and preparing to sail for America, where his parents had already settled. Leaving England by crowded steerage, Hill, accompanied by Anne and their three young children, sailed from Liverpool and arrived in this country on March 22, 1858. The trip in second cabin took 8 days, and when they docked at the pier in New York Harbor, they arrived in a city teeming with immigrants. The streets were thronged with horses and wagons and pushcart vendors from whom you could buy a pickle or a cabbage or a live chicken. If you walked uptown on Broadway, the crowds and big buildings dwindled after 14th Street, and the area known as Herald Square was considered the countryside. Up on 59th Street, a beautiful park was about to open. It was modeled on a picturesque park in England that Hill knew well, Birkenhead Park, and perhaps he wondered why it had no name other than the Central Park. Our first indication of Hill's whereabouts in America surfaces in the 1860 federal census. He and Anne were living in Yonkers, north of the city, a stretch of verdant dairy farms. Moving into the home of his widowed father, they stayed long enough for a daughter to be born in 1861. Immediately afterward, he moved his family to Hoboken, New Jersey, which was closer to the city, directly across the river from Manhattan, on the west bank of the Hudson. White-painted ferries and steamships glided by all day. Throughout the Civil War, Hill lived in Hoboken, an artist immigrant gazing out over the river. He got off to a promising start. He landed a job with Currier and Ives, the famous printmakers, who were based in Manhattan. Neither Nathaniel Currier nor James Merritt Ives was actually an artist. Rather, they were marketing wizards who employed dozens of artists and devised the ingenious idea of advertising their art inventory in attractive catalogs they published themselves. Some of the prints were engraved copies of paintings, but most of them were original images drawn by artists who remained unacknowledged. The prints were run off in black and white, and then, after drying for a day or so, were finished by low-paid women who sat at long tables with stencils and pots of brightly colored inks. The shop at 152 Nassau Street advertised itself as a grand depot for cheap and popular prints, which was actually true. Anyone could drop by and browse through the racks of hand-colored lithographs. The inventory was constantly changing, although certain motifs were nearly sacrosanct, such as rural landscapes with two-story farmhouses and split-rail fences and horses trotting along a dirt road. Many of the prints seemed to say, "We'll all feel better with some fresh country air." An inexplicably large number portray snow-covered farmhouses with light playing off the rooftops and ground, as if it were possible to leach the grayness not only out of art, but out of winter as well. The prints may have been technically awkward or unpolished, but they were usually lively, jammed with lots of informative details. And they were certainly reasonable. Prices, according to the firm's 1860 catalog, started at 8 cents and went up to more than $3. Any housewife could afford to buy a lithograph to frame and hang in the parlor. Moreover, you could have the pleasure of exercising your taste by picking out one from among hundreds, preferably one that expressed the sincere ideas and tastes of the house and not the tyrannical dicta of some art critic or neighbor. As Harriet Beecher Stowe put it in her best-selling advice book, The American Woman's Home in 1869. Her comment remains the only takedown to dismiss art critics and neighbors with equal harshness. Nothing is viewed as more quintessentially American than Currier and Ives prints, but the irony is that most of the firm's illustrators were British emigres. Many good scenes of the Rocky Mountains were produced by Currier and Ives artists who had trained in London and never traveled very far west of the Hudson River. Hill didn't last long at the Currier and Ives shop. Whether he was too mercurial to hold down a job or too self-regarding to submit to the drudgery of copying paintings by other artists, he soon went off on his own. This is the period when he started painting groupings of ducks and quails in scenic landscapes, and it seems likely that he was influenced by James John Audubon's famous illustrations. It had been a generation since Audubon had published his Birds of America, with its hand-colored engravings of every species he could find. Some of Hill's paintings combine images of Audubon birds with a woodsy landscape setting. Most of his paintings were done on small canvases, about 10 by 12 inches, and some are just 6 by 11 inches. They're painted in a tight, detail-laden style, and when they err, it's on the side of preciousness. In New York, the economy boomed during the Civil War, and Hill prospered. He took a studio in Manhattan and was listed in the city directory as Howard Hill, Artist, 609 Broadway, Residence, Hoboken. In 1865, four of his bird paintings were included in the most important survey show of the year, the 40th Annual Exhibition at the National Academy of Design, which had just moved into a grand new building on East 23rd Street. At the time, the Academy was the foremost art school and museum in the city. In fact, it was the only art museum. There was no Metropolitan Museum of Art. There were no public rooms where you could see a Rembrandt or a Vermeer, or even minor Dutch masters. The Manhattan art world then consisted of little more than the National Academy and some commercial shops down on Nassau Street, where middling paintings were auctioned off like so much old furniture. There were a few art dealers, but their loyalty was to fashionable French artists, such as Adolphe William Bouguereau, who painted female nudes with silky skin and cherubs fluttering in the sky. American artists were left to dispose of their work at group exhibitions, the most important one being the Academy's annuals. On April 27, 1865, less than 2 weeks after the assassination of President Lincoln, the Academy held an opening reception for its 40th annual exhibition. Despite the recent tragedy, it proved to be a glittery social event. A writer for Harper's Weekly took note of the gay and flashing groups of visitors. The women wore gowns, the men were in frocks and silk top hats. They gathered in sumptuous rooms with Persian carpets to look at paintings that were hung salon style from floor to ceiling. More than 100 artists were in the show, all of them at the mercy of the hanging committee, as it was called, somewhat ominously. Artists who had prayed to God that their work would be granted a central eye-level spot were likely to have spent opening night wondering why their pictures had been relegated to the hazy margins. Humbler painters, on the other hand, were no doubt thrilled to find themselves in such prestigious company. The speakers that night included William Cullen Bryant, the long-bearded nature poet and newspaper editor, who praised the Academy as an institution that had finally reached its ripe maturity. So, for one all-too-brief moment, Hill was a man whose career appeared to be ascendant, a British emigre whose life intersected with the brightest stars in American art. Winslow Homer, Albert Bierstadt, George Innes, and Sanford Gifford were among his co-exhibitors at the Academy, and he may have personally met them at the opening reception. Perhaps he shook their hands, or even had a brief chat. Or perhaps he didn't, and was sick with regret when he got home that night. This was the heyday of landscape painting in America, and Bierstadt was the most celebrated of the lot. He painted sweeping views of the American West, scenes of tall cliffs and orangey sunsets that seemed designed to show space at its most abundant, to insert miles of dewy vapor between you and the mountain peaks. One of the mysteries of Hill's career is that he didn't endow his pictures with similar grandeur. Although he lived on top of the Hudson River, in Yonkers to the east and then in Hoboken to the west, he never painted a river view. Perhaps he was indifferent to romantic vistas. Perhaps, instead of inspiring him, they intimidated him. Distant views, especially those of mountains, diminished the observer to a tiny speck, to insignificance. Hill preferred things you can see at close range, not views exactly, but objects within your own space, the space you inhabit every day from the moment you get out of bed and feel the floorboards beneath your bare feet. He preferred his birds. He had a real sympathy for them. Not swift ones tearing through the sky, but birds that exhibited no desire to fly, that were content to bump around on the ground. No photographs of Hill are known to survive. No letters either. As a result, his appearance and his ideas about painting remain largely unknown to us, and his life story must be jiggered together from family stories and whatever scant mention he received in newspapers and other documents. After appearing in two annuals at the National Academy in as many years, his name disappears for a while. It pops up again in 1868 and 1869 in small print classified advertisements in the New York Herald. The ads were placed by the auctioneer Philip Levy, who sold choice oil paintings at the artist's sales room on Nassau Street. Hill was one of the artists in his stable. He surfaces next in the 1870 census, which describes him as a 40-year-old artiste, as if he were French. His wife gave her occupation as keeping house. They were no longer in Hoboken, but one town over in Jersey City. The value of his personal estate was estimated at $300, and unlike some of his neighbors, who included a brick mason and a produce dealer, Hill didn't own his house. He had a large brood by now, six children ranging from an 18-year-old daughter to a baby boy. The three oldest children had been born back in London, the fourth in Yonkers. The two youngest, Annie and Percy, were born in New Jersey. Annie was Norman Rockwell's future mother. She was named for her own mother, Anne Hill. She would be called Nancy to minimize confusion, which actually maximized confusion. The Jersey City years appear to have been a relatively prosperous and halcyon time. Hill was still selling an occasional picture. In May of 1873, he appeared in a show at the Brooklyn Art Gallery. The show was called, with more than a bit of hyperbole, Modern Oil Paintings of the Highest Class, and included Hill's Bevy of Quail. Just 4 months later, in September, a terrible depression swept the country. The panic of 1873 began with the collapse of the Philadelphia investment house of J. Cook and Company, which had financed the construction of the country's railroads and assumed with unearned confidence that money for laying down new tracks would never run out. Its miscalculation resulted in its ruin, set off other bank failures around the country, and brought on what remains known as the Long Depression. Hill, chased by creditors and unable to make his rent, moved his family back to Yonkers, where his widowed father still resided, albeit in rather modest circumstances. The father rented a room in the home of an English-born couple and scraped by as a furniture dealer. Howard Hill rented a poky little dwelling on Woodworth Avenue, which ran along the banks of the Hudson. His immediate plan was to earn a living by obtaining commissions from well-to-do farmers in Yonkers. He would traipse from house to house, offering his services and mentioning his unique talent for painting hens and roosters. On countless afternoons, he could be found sitting in a barnyard, sketching and sketching, trying to capture a pair of white chickens scratching in the packed dirt, or a large dog sleeping in the shade of a tree. Compared to his earlier work, the cozy families of grown birds and chicks, some of his later paintings convey a nervous energy. The animals can seem more isolated, a chicken pecking beside an open barn door, a rooster with a spiky red crown appearing a little alarmed. He became known as the town eccentric, a moody, unkempt man who alienated most everyone he met. Evenings, he would head into town and make the rounds of the taverns. Invariably, he would return home sloshed, tripping over kitchen chairs and muttering obscenities. His children were woken in the middle of the night by the sound of him clomping around and grew to fear him. Stories circulated about his lapses and misadventures. He once took his children into the village and returned home without them. When he was in high spirits, he liked to buy up surplus goods. There was the time he returned from a shopping spree with 12 pairs of children's shoes, all of them the same size. Inevitably, his career withered. He sold so few pictures he was reduced to painting houses to make ends meet. Then he had an idea. Perhaps there was profit to be made in turning out paintings in bulk. He would devote himself to schemes to fill a saleable rectangle, as the critic Julian Bell once said of another artist in another context. Borrowing the production line method he'd learned during his stint at Currier and Ives, he enlisted his children as his staff artists. And so he became the head of a workshop, putting his children to work in the production of sentimental pictures of Indian maidens on moonlit lakes and tearful mothers bidding their grown sons farewell. His usual practice was to have the children sit at a long wooden table. Hill would sit at the head of the table and pass along a canvas on which he'd laid in the background. One child would add a moon, another a lake, another a forest, and so on, until the painting was almost done and Hill had only to add a few touches and his signature. He was paid as much as $25 for a picture that came with a frame. By now, his older children were out of the house and faring well in the workaday world. His oldest son, Thomas J. Hill, had an art career of his own. He'd trained in his father's studio as an animalier, or animal painter. The first painting he exhibited at the National Academy, this was in 1876, was listed in the catalog as Chipmunk's Home and offered for sale for $100. Unlike his father, who'd made his second and last appearance at the National Academy in 1866, the younger Hill would continue to show in its annual surveys. Although he lacked his father's depth as a painter, he was a considerate and thoughtful man who was well-liked by his peers, traits which in art, as in everything else, can carry a person a certain distance. Howard Hill's problems worsened considerably in 1886. On the morning of April 25th, his wife died of pneumonia, aged 57. Pneumonia, before the discovery of penicillin, was a devastating disease that brought on violent fevers and sweats. It could kill you in a matter of days, and Anne Hill's death certificate notes that she'd been sick for only 7 or 8 days. She died at home on Woodworth Avenue and was buried in the yard of the Episcopal Church to which she belonged. The stone that marks her grave bears a pithy, poignant inscription: Mama. 4 months later, another tragedy befell Hill. Thomas J. Hill, his eldest son, the artist, now 29, died of the same disease that killed his mother. He'd been sick with pneumonia for only 3 days, according to his death certificate. These were grievous times for Howard Hill. His wife was dead, and his son Tom had joined her, both of them lying in the small, grassy churchyard in the middle of town. Unable to keep house, exhausted by the pressures of trying to earn his living as an artist, Hill spent his last year and a half reduced to living as a vagrant. Traveling with little more than his jars of paint and his brushes and his candles, he moved between rooming houses in New York and Yonkers. He had no home address because he had no home. It went on like that, week after week. One Monday in February 1888, Hill went to New York on business and returned to Yonkers 1 week later, at midnight. The morning after his return, according to the local newspaper, he was found in an epileptic fit. Presumably, he suffered a stroke. He died a day later, on March 6, 1888. At 5 o'clock in the morning, at the boarding house of Mrs. Nagel on New Main Street. He was 57 years old. He was buried at St. John's Cemetery in an unmarked grave. 2 days later, the great blizzard of 1888 descended, terrifying the people of Yonkers with howling winds and endless snowfall, and causing all the birds to freeze to death. Here, then, is Norman Rockwell's mother. Here is Nancy Hill. Born in Hoboken on March 6, 1866, she was the fifth of Howard Hill's six children. The Tuesday on which her father died was her 22nd birthday. From that day on, she was an orphan. At the time, she was living in a boarding house on Ravine Avenue in Yonkers, sharing a room with her older sister, Katie, a teacher. A petite, darkly pretty woman, Nancy already had a boyfriend who was precisely what she wanted. He was kind and dependable. He was someone who could carry her away from the squalor of her past, away from the drinking binges and the chickens and roosters, away from the whole miserable experience of art. She never wanted to inhale the greasy scent of oil paint again. Nancy found the perfect suitor when she met Jarvis Waring Rockwell, Norman Rockwell's father, who went by his middle name. He was a salesman for a textile company in Manhattan. He, too, grew up in Yonkers, but in the good part of town, in a stately house at 98 Ashburton Avenue, never having to worry about money. Waring had a handsome face, with brown eyes and a substantial mustache kept neatly trimmed. His speaking voice was deep, and he sang bass in the church choir of his youth. When he was in his early 20s, he joined several amateur singing groups, and his appearances were noted respectfully in the pages of the Yonkers Statesman. He warbled with the Canoe Club Quintet and sang in Gilbert and Sullivan operettas, including the first production of The Mikado in Yonkers. born on December 18, 1867, the youngest of three children, Waring grew up in a family that, thankfully for him, was less colorful than his wife's. His father, John William Rockwell, was a wholesale coal dealer who ran his own business out of a landmark building, 1 Broadway, in Manhattan. His mother, Phoebe Boyce Waring, can fairly be described as Yonkers aristocracy. She was descended from the founder of the Waring Manufacturing Company, which was once the nation's largest hat maker and at its peak turned out 7,000 hats a day. In the summer of 1891, Waring was 23. Nancy was 25. It's not known how they met, only that they'd been dating for a few years and their relatives wondered if they would ever marry. Waring was willing to do whatever Nancy wanted. She wanted to marry that summer up in Crompton, Rhode Island, where she was living in the house of her older sister. And she wanted to marry in the Episcopal Church, which was fine with Waring, although he'd grown up attending services at the First Presbyterian Church. News of the nuptials made page one of the Yonkers Statesman, which reported, "The bride was attired in a handsome costume of white, with veil, and carried a bouquet of white roses. After a wedding tour, Mr. and Mrs. Rockwell will reside in New York City." The newlyweds rented an apartment on the Upper West Side of Manhattan, in a narrow brownstone at 206 West 103rd Street, off Amsterdam Avenue. They'd been married for little more than a year when Nancy gave birth at home to their first son, Jarvis Waring Rockwell Jr., on September 29, 1892. In less than a year, Nancy was pregnant again. On February 3, 1894, a second son was born. It was her turn to pick a name. Astoundingly, instead of naming him after her artist father Howard or her adored brother Thomas J. Hill, she named him after a man she'd never met, one Captain Norman Spencer Percival, a minor British nobleman who'd married her mother's sister. The captain was still alive at the time, ensconced on Lowndes Street in London, and he appealed to Nancy's nostalgia for an England she'd never visited except in the mists of her imagination. Perhaps she hoped that Captain Percival would leave some money to her son, or perhaps it was enough for her to know that she and her newborn, Norman Percival Rockwell, by virtue of the name she'd given him, were now linked for the ages to a name out of British royal history. She no doubt would have been thrilled to learn that Captain Norman Spencer Percival was linked to the future Diana Spencer, Princess of Wales, by a mere 21 degrees of genealogical separation. Rockwell always hated his middle name and believed that Percival was about as embarrassing as any word ever appended to a boy. His mother was constantly reminding him to spell it correctly, the way that Captain Percival did. The captain spelled it P-E-R-C-E-V-A-L, as opposed to the common spelling of P-E-R-C-I-V-A-L. This may explain why Rockwell actually misspelled his own middle name in his autobiography. He spelled it throughout as P-E-R-C-E-V-E-L, as if so anxious about overlooking the letter E that he inserted one in the place of every vowel. People need something to carry their fantasies. And for Nancy Rockwell, the lines and bloodlines of family trees were a convenient conveyor. In later life, she came to believe that her father, poor Howard Hill, was descended from British royalty. "My father's great-great-great-grandmother was Lady Elizabeth Howard. She was beheaded," she noted in a letter to her daughter-in-law in 1946. At the time, she was reading a new historical novel about the girlhood of Elizabeth I, Young Bess, by Margaret Irwin. She highly recommended it. "If you wish to read something about my father's ancestors." Rockwell, by contrast, had little interest in his ancestors. When he thought of his origins, he preferred to dwell on his artistic origins and various painter gods to whom he felt connected. They were a far-flung lot, ranging from European masters like Peter Bruegel the Elder, Rembrandt, and Jean-François Millet, to the American illustrator of pirates, Howard Pyle. The history of painting is its own extended family, and the one from which Rockwell believed he inherited his best qualities. Chapter 2. Not a Norman Rockwell childhood. 1894 to 1911. In his later years, when Rockwell tried to picture his parents, one memory invariably sprang to mind. It's early evening in New York City, and Norman, who's maybe 10 or 11, is sitting in the dim stairwell of the brownstone building where the family lived. He hears the front door of the building creak open and the sound of his father coming up the stairs. Waring, a textile salesman, is tired from his day at work and the hour-long ride on the trolley. He enters the apartment, and Norman can hear him ask in his deep baritone, "Well now, Nancy, how are you?"
"Oh, Waring, I've had such a hard day. I'm just worn out."
"Now, Nancy, you just lie down on the couch there and I'll get a cold towel for your head."
Waring would close the door, and all Norman could hear was the sound of his mother's lamentations. To his annoyance, his father would sit at her side, hat in his hand, dark eyes filled with understanding and sympathy, as if he'd never heard her story before. Rockwell had a surprisingly unsentimental view of his childhood. He wrote his autobiography, or rather dictated it to his son Thomas Rockwell, in 1959, by which time his parents had died. He characterized his father as weak and ineffective. He spoke of his mother as a hypochondriac who occupied her days visiting doctors. She passed countless afternoons lying in bed or on the parlor sofa, the lamp turned low, a table of pills beside her. Rockwell later insisted that she spent most of his childhood supine. He wanted her to stand up. He wanted her to ask him about his day.
"I was never close to my mother," Rockwell noted matter-of-factly. "When I was a child, she'd call me into her bedroom and say to me, 'Norman Percival, you must always love and honor your mother. She needs you.' Somehow that put a barrier between us." He believed she'd taken over his father's life, reduced Waring to her nurse. It seemed to him that women were self-absorbed, and men were the caring ones. Men were the ones to whom you could entrust your well-being. His father worked for the New York division of a Philadelphia-based cotton goods company, George Wood Sons and Company. Every so often, he would come home from the office beaming, and Norman knew instantly what had happened that day. Sitting down to dinner, after Nancy had said grace, Waring would unfold his napkin and arrange it carefully across his knees. Then he would announce with satisfaction, "Mr. Wood was in the office today." And he would recount his conversation with Mr. Wood verbatim. Growing up, Rockwell felt neglected by his parents and overshadowed by his older brother Jarvis, a first-rate student and athlete who was 1 year ahead of him in school. Norman, by contrast, was slight and pigeon-toed and squinted at the world through owlish glasses. His grades were barely passing, and he struggled with reading and writing. Today, he surely would be labeled dyslexic. "I wasn't a regular Huckleberry Finn or Tom Sawyer," he later recalled. "I wasn't an excessively brave kid. I wasn't very healthy. My brother was quite the opposite, and this had a lot to do with my life." He later played semi-professional baseball and football. He was the real boy's boy. After reading The Little Lame Prince, a short story by Dinah Maria Mulock Craik, Rockwell tried to garner notice by walking around school with an exaggerated limp and pretending to have just one hand. "I wanted to be an artist, or I wanted to be noticed as lame or anything, because I felt I couldn't compete with my brother because he was so strong and husky." Rockwell spent his first 12 years in a series of cramped apartments in Upper Manhattan. When he was 2 years old, the family left West 103rd Street and moved up to 789 St. Nicholas Avenue in Harlem, which was considered a better neighborhood. Then, when he was 6 years old, he and his family moved in with his father's elderly parents at 832 St. Nicholas Avenue, on the corner of 152nd Street. It's not clear how Rockwell felt about his paternal grandfather, the coal dealer from Yonkers, whom he once described in an unpublished essay as quite a swell and a gay blade, despite his financial losses in the depression-addled 1890s. He bequeathed Rockwell a hand-me-down that became the bane of his childhood, a pretentious double-breasted overcoat with a moss-green velvet collar that elicited mocking laughter from his classmates. Rockwell made no mention of the sadder events that occurred around this time. Grandma Phoebe died in March 1903, and the funeral service was held in the apartment. 2 winters earlier, there had been another death in the family, that of Rockwell's Aunt Grace, not yet 40, his father's sister and the mother of 2 boys, Sherman and Halsey, all of them ensconced in that same building on St. Nicholas Avenue. Rockwell was a turn-of-the-century kid, born just in time to observe the arrival of the 20th century. Historians tend to describe this period as if everything considered modern, subways, movie theaters, tall buildings, arrived on cue with the new century. Yet the 19th century, with its bumpy cobblestones and gas lanterns, its dim apartments in which mothers gave birth, continued well into the 20th century. And up on St. Nicholas Avenue, the 19th century hadn't fully departed. In the mornings, the men rushed to catch the trolley to work, and the women stayed home, leaning on the sills of open windows and counting the errands that had to be done. Rockwell didn't view his childhood as the beginning of the modern era. He didn't see it as the beginning of anything. But perhaps it seemed like a time of endings. He was 6 years old when Queen Victoria, an ancient matriarch whose name had come to be identified with an entire age, died. Later that year, President William McKinley was visiting Buffalo, New York, when he was shot by an assassin. Rockwell never forgot the horror in the streets on the night of the president's death, with newsboys shouting, "Extra, extra!" as people rushed from their apartments and huddled beneath the yellow glare of gas lamps to read the news. No one had a radio yet. The next day, Norman went to church with his family, and both of his parents cried. A devout Episcopalian, Nancy required her sons to say grace before dinner and to attend church. The family worshiped at St. Luke's Episcopal Church on West 141st Street and Convent Avenue. For Norman, a dreary obligation that instilled in him a lifelong aversion to organized religion. He sang in the all-boys church choir year after year. This required three rehearsals during the week after school, the last of which, on Friday evenings, was a dress rehearsal. On Sundays, when Norman and Jarvis returned from church, the boys were forbidden from playing with their toys. Nor were they allowed to look at the funny pages. "We couldn't read them until Monday," Rockwell recalled. There was one part of his childhood for which he retained affectionate memories. In the summer, the family would take a 2-week vacation in the Adirondack Mountains on a working farm that rented out rooms. The place was owned by the sprawling Jessup family and located in the town that's now Warwick, New York. Years later, Rockwell recalled indolent afternoons when the grown-ups played croquet and the children were free to do as they pleased. What he seemed to cherish was the communality of it all. He warmed to the memory of hayrides on which everyone squeezed into a wagon and sang as the horses trotted along country roads. He recalled the excitement of eating lunch with the threshing crew at the long board tables. The Jessup children thought of him as less hearty than the other children. Norman was considered delicate and had to have eggnogs between meals, Phoebe Jessup noted years later. One of my duties was to prepare them. When did Rockwell realize he wanted to be an artist? He first demonstrated a talent for drawing when he was 6 or 7, as he recalled. His father was a casual smoker, and in those days, each pack of American Fleet cigarettes came with a trading card that portrayed a model of a battleship. Kids liked to collect the cards. Norman, instead, liked to copy them. With his pencil and eraser, he worked with great industry and concentration, careful to get every detail right. There was much smudgy erasing. His brother, Jarvis, was impressed by the drawings, so much so that he and his friends targeted them for immediate destruction. They would assemble whole fleets on the floor and, boom, declare war, trying to destroy each other's ships with a pair of scissors. "It was a sort of frustrating art form for me," Rockwell later said. Actually, Jarvis drew pictures of ships as well, one of which can be found among the Rockwell family papers. It's a charming crayon drawing, a battleship on stormy waters, 4 flags waving in the breeze. Although Norman always spoke of his brother as the family athlete, all brawn and strutting pride, the label was reductive. Jarvis was a dexterous child, good with his hands and fond of building. In later life, he ended up designing toys for a living. Norman soon graduated from sketches of battleships to scenes culled from literature. On weekday evenings, after he and Jarvis had finished their homework, the boys would sit at the dining room table as their father read novels to them. There was lots of Charles Dickens. Norman, hunched at the table, the ever-present pencil in his right hand, took great pains with his drawings. He worked slowly, revising as he went, and seeming to erase almost as many lines as he drew. He later recalled sketching a likeness of Mr. Micawber while his father read David Copperfield, only to erase the head and ask his father to read the pertinent description again. The passage about Mr. Micawber's bald cranium. So, his father read it again, the sentence about this stoutish, middle-aged person with no more hair upon his head than there is upon an egg.
Rockwell won his first prize in December 1905 for a now-lost drawing he entered in the New York Herald's Young Contributors Contest. He was 11 years old. Despite his early interest in art, Rockwell didn't visit a museum until he was quite a bit older. When he felt like looking at pictures, he scarcely needed to venture to the Metropolitan Museum. Instead, he might sit down at the dining room table and open up the latest number of Collier's or Harper's Monthly or St. Nicholas Magazine and pore over the illustrations, the line drawings, and paintings by Howard Pyle or Frederick Remington or Edwin Austin Abbey. In truth, there was more new art by American artists to be found in magazines than there was on the walls of museums. This was the period known as the Golden Age of Illustration, although it was only in nostalgic retrospect that the phrase encompassed events in America. Initially, it referred to a movement that began in London in the 60s, the 1860s, that is, when leading English artists tried their hand at wood engraving in order to furnish pictures for books and magazines. At the time, an artist could cross from easel painting to illustration with impunity. No one thought less of Sir John Everett Millais because he drew illustrations for trollop novels that were published serially in the magazine once a week, although eyebrows did go up when he committed the mercenary sin of allowing his painting of a very blonde, bubble-blowing boy, Bubbles, to appear on the wrapper of Pear's soap. In America, magazine illustration didn't gain much aesthetic momentum until the 1880s. It had to wait for the arrival of Howard Pyle, a brilliant Quaker artist and writer. He's often called the father of American illustration, a dreary cliche, but a fittingly patriarchal image for a man who spawned a progeny of famous illustrators from N.C. Wyeth on down, and ran a school out of his studio in Wilmington, Delaware. More important than the school was Pyle's own oeuvre, a shelf of children's classics that elevated American illustration to the level it enjoyed in Europe. His admirers included Vincent van Gogh, who once wrote, in a letter to his brother, "Do you know of an American magazine called Harper's Monthly? There are things in it that strike me dumb with admiration, including sketches of a Quaker town in the olden days by Howard Pyle." Pyle was Rockwell's favorite, hands down. Rockwell would study reproductions of his paintings of colonial America and marvel at their vividness. When Pyle painted the story of the American Revolution, he imported the lofty goals of history painting, that is, factual accuracy, into the realm of popular illustration. He would track down the right musket and the right tricorn hat. He would labor to paint the right number of bricks in a background wall 100 feet off. He wanted to relate the past at its most present, its most lifelike. His painting of George Washington at Valley Forge makes you feel the wind blowing through double-breasted buttoned-up coats, the crunch of boots on snow. When unsure about a certain detail, he might run down to Washington and take a photograph. And perhaps it was his camera eyes as much as anything that fascinated the young Rockwell. He particularly loved Pyle's pirates, those long-haired, eye-patched thugs who kept their stolen booty in trunks. Here were Blackbeard and the rest, the seamen who terrorized the early American colonists. Although they came with the same guarantee of historical authenticity or your money back as his other motifs, Pyle's pirates, with their headscarves knotted in the back and hoop earrings,
have since been exposed as mostly fiction. Their clothing has less in common with actual pirates' duds than with the flamboyant outfits of Spanish gypsies. They reveal Pyle as a second-rate researcher, but a fabulous illustrator, and they became the go-to images for most every film about pirates. In 1959, Rockwell's painting, Family Tree, graced the cover of the Saturday Evening Post. It traces a little boy's genealogical origins back several generations to, of all people, one of Pyle's black-bearded pirates. Readers of the Post interpreted the painting as a joke about unsavory relatives, but it was also a touching acknowledgement on the part of Rockwell that he saw Pyle as the patriarch of his family, that is, the family of illustrators with whom he felt closely identified. Perhaps Howard Pyle struck him as the realized version of Howard Hill. The two Howards, one a pauper, the other a legend, and an appropriately potent figure for a boy to want to claim as a forebear. In September 1906, when Rockwell was 12 years old, his city days came to an end. Later, he tended to speak of New York City as a menacing place and shuddered at the memory of a scene he'd witnessed one winter afternoon. Not a violent crime, just a couple having a drunken argument in a vacant lot. Brandishing an umbrella, the woman struck the man until he fell to the ground. She became my image of the city, Rockwell wrote, as if the woman were the evil twin of the Statue of Liberty. But one shouldn't read too much geographical bias into this, because Rockwell would come to feel similarly imperiled in Mamaroneck, New York, a quiet, woodsy suburb where his family settled. Grandpa Rockwell made the move with them into a rented house whose address is now 415 Prospect Avenue, near the corner of Fenimore Road. Though hardly grand, at least it was a house, a spacious white clapboard with a long front porch and a garden in the back. It had three bedrooms and sunny windows. When Norman stood on the corner and looked south, he could catch a glimpse of Long Island Sound. In the summer, the water was full of sails. He went through public school in Mamaroneck, and already art was his main interest. It was, in truth, the only subject on which he could concentrate that forced his sprawling thoughts into focus. Whenever a teacher turned to face the blackboard or looked down at a lesson book for any length of time, he would resume drawing on the pad that he carried with him. He was still going through his Howard Pyle pirate phase, and most of his drawings involved tautly muscled men and eye patches and sword fights. In October 1906, the family joined St. Thomas Episcopal Church, a handsome country church in Mamaroneck on a hill overlooking the Sound. For the next year and a half, until his confirmation, Rockwell attended services every Sunday and once again sang in the choir. It was less arduous than the choir at his previous church, which was a relief. Yet, he didn't seem to care for the rector, the Reverend Frank F. German, and was bothered by his method for polishing the cross on the altar. He'd spit on it and rub it with a soiled cloth, Rockwell recalled, and you suspect the gesture was less an affront to his spirituality than to his sense of cleanliness, which was already becoming obsessive. He found his own house shabby. He later recalled the pinched and faded tidiness of the front parlor with its yellowed, washed-out antimacassars on the sofa. He even remembered the texture of the bath towels, which his mother didn't bother to replace until the nap was worn away and you could see through them.
His parents were always scrimping and saving, fretting over pennies. His mother would ask, "Waring, should we have a roast this Sunday?"
And Waring would reply, "Not this week, I think, Nancy." Instead, they had stew. Hardly a catastrophe, this business of stew, but Rockwell, like many boys, was beset by exaggerated feelings of deprivation.
As he entered adolescence, he came to believe that in every way that mattered, he was powerless. He harbored no hope that he might ever possess the physical prowess of other boys. He didn't train for any teams and learned to accept the bitter fact of his brother's seemingly effortless popularity.
Bob Titus, a big, handsome athlete who'd been my closest friend, Rockwell lamented of a boy who lived on his block, drifted away from me and began to hang around with Jarvis. It didn't help that he grew up at a time when the male body, as much as the mind, had come to be viewed as something to be improved and expanded. In addition to celebrity bodybuilders like Eugen Zondo, better known as Zondo the Magnificent, President Theodore Roosevelt himself was an advocate of body modification. Much of Rockwell's childhood, ages 7 to 15, took place during the daunting athleticism of Teddy Roosevelt's presidency. All of America knew the story of how he had transformed his sickly, delicate, asthmatic body into the 200-pound muscular, barrel-chested figure of a supremely strong and energetic leader, as historian John F. Kasson puts it. He was the naturalist president who hiked for miles and hunted big game. After leaving office, he sailed to Africa and posed for photographers in a pith helmet and safari gear. In the TR era, the well-developed male body became a kind of physical analog to America's expansionist, big-stick foreign policy. To be a good American was to build your deltoids and acquire a powerful chest. Rockwell tried exercising, hoping for a transformation. In the mornings, he diligently did push-ups, knee bends, and jumping jacks in front of the half-length mirror in his bedroom. But the images he glimpsed in the mirror, the pale face, the narrow shoulders, and the spaghetti arms, continued to strike him as wholly unappealing. At least he had art. He was beginning to get recognition for it at school. Miss Julia M. Smith, his eighth grade teacher, a single woman in her late 30s, would ask him to come up to the front of the classroom and draw pictures in chalk on the blackboard as the other students watched. When she was lecturing on American history, he drew revolutionary soldiers and covered wagons, the sort he knew well from the work of Pyle. When the subject turned to science, he drew birds and lions and other members of the animal kingdom. Miss Smith fussed over his drawings. She made him feel that he was artistic and hence special and not required to live by the rules, that being artistic somehow made up for his failure to excel at baseball. He would keep in touch with her for the rest of her life, and she is one of the few people from his childhood for whom he admitted to feeling a special fondness. Later, he would marry three times, and each time he married a schoolteacher. On September 7, 1909, Norman began his freshman year at Mamaroneck High School and 3 years of unremitting academic struggle. His school transcript is an alarming document, lined with grades that hovered just a few points above passing. Compared to Jarvis, a solid student, Norman was always perilously close to flunking. During his freshman year, he was required to take Latin and perform dreaded feats of memorization, Later, he took 2 years of French and felt overwhelmed by irregular verbs. The subject that gave him the most trouble was math. In his sophomore year, he studied algebra and was confounded by the flurry of X's and Y's that were suddenly descending in the spaces where numbers used to be. He got a grade of 50 in algebra his first quarter, which must have seemed like a new low, until his third term, when he scored an impressively abysmal 28. During his high school years, he drew caricatures and imagined becoming a professional cartoonist. His mother's cousin, John Orpin, the president of the Providence Ice Company, was amused by sketches that portrayed him as a lowly laborer, chopping ice behind the ice wagon. When the Mamaroneck Avenue School opened, it was reported Rockwell did the mural decorations, which consisted of charcoal and pencil sketches, mostly caricatures of the teachers, on the newly calcimined walls. It was the heyday of humor magazines, which were well stocked with caricatures and cartoons. Life was the most genteel of the lot. It was unrelated to the magazine of the same title founded later by Henry Luce. Judge was a cheap-looking rival with bad taste jokes about women, blacks, and immigrants. Puck was located in the landmark building still known as the Puck Building on Lafayette Street in New York. One day when he was in the city, Rockwell went around to all three magazines and showed his drawings to various art editors. They were very kind, insisting that his work showed the greatest talent. Then they recommended that he go to art school. He was crushed. Rockwell perpetuated certain inaccuracies concerning himself and his life. He preferred to make his life into a comic story and so took liberty with facts. For instance, although he described his mother as a self-absorbed invalid, she and Waring were both inordinately supportive of his efforts at art. His mother especially raved over his pen and ink drawings. She was sure he'd inherited his talent from her father and her brother. She thought even his most tortured drawings showed promise and preserved the ones he didn't throw out, pasting them into scrapbooks. "I regret to tell you, for fear of spoiling a good story," Rockwell said in one of his earliest interviews, decades before his autobiography offered a conflicting account, "that both my parents encouraged my drawing energetically from the time I was a small boy. Moreover, when he entered Mamaroneck High School, his mother made arrangements with his teachers to have him excused early so he could take classes at prestigious art schools in New York City. Initially, he went once a week to the New York School of Art, popularly known as the Chase School, after its founder, William Merritt Chase. Then he switched to the National Academy of Art, where he enrolled in the antique class and found himself seated in a large room ringed by white casts of Venus and Hercules. The reason why you're studying in what they call antique class is because the model doesn't move," Rockwell later explained. The 1910 census listed the Rockwells as a large clan. Waring continued to scrape by as a salesman, dry goods. His widowed father, John W. Rockwell, was still living with the family, and Mrs. Rockwell's 30-year-old niece, Eva Milnes, was also listed as a boarder. Norman was now 16 years old, and Jarvis, at 17, was described as a clerk, shoe store. The detail is puzzling. Jarvis selling shoes. Although he'd been an excellent student, he dropped out of high school after his junior year. Entered business in New York City, reports a note on the back of his school transcript.
His parents never considered sending him to college. College, as they saw it, was for boys from rich families. Like many other financially strapped parents of their time, Waring and Nancy expected their sons to enter trades as soon as they could and help supplement the household income. Norman, too, felt pressured to earn money and was working at various part-time jobs. In the summer of 1910, a wealthy matron mentioned to the Reverend German at his church that she and a friend were thinking of taking art lessons. The friend turned out to be Ethel Barrymore, whom Rockwell was happy to oblige. Barrymore, at the time a young Broadway actress who spoke in a noticeably throaty voice, had just bought a summer place in Mamaroneck, in the exclusive Orienta section, a strip of shoreline fringed with mansions. She'd already been sketched by portraitists, including John Singer Sargent, although it didn't occur to 16-year-old Rockwell to ask her to pose. Instead, he was content to carry her paint box and paddle the two women in a canoe across Mamaroneck Harbor to Hen Island. He would set up their easels and supplies and watch as they dipped the tips of their brushes in little mounds of pigment that he'd taught them how to mix. After an hour, it was time for a picnic lunch and then the return trip. At the end of that summer, he secured another job serving Mamaroneck's elite. He took over the mail route in Orienta. It was too far from downtown to be serviced by a regular mailman, so residents paid for private delivery. On weekday mornings, before school, Norman would bicycle to the post office, load a pile of letters into his shoulder bag, and head off on his route. He liked bicycle riding, liked whisking through town in the pale light of early morning. In May 1911, at the end of his junior year, Norman dropped out of high school and made plans to study art in New York. He claimed in his autobiography that he dropped out in the middle of his sophomore year, perhaps an innocent confusion of dates. He was 17 years old, and his boyhood was over. But it would live on in his paintings. Boyhood would be one of the great themes of his art, and it would give him the chance to rewrite the whole story. Chapter 3. The Art Students League, September 1911 to 1912. In October 1911, Rockwell enrolled at the Art Students League of New York, which occupied a palatial building on West 57th Street. The League liked to think of itself as a progressive place, the anti-academic academy. It issued no grades, kept no attendance records, and prescribed no specific course of study. Students could sign up on a monthly basis with any artist professors who interested them or drop classes with impunity. For Rockwell, the League was appealing because it was the only art school in the city where book illustration was taken seriously. Howard Pyle had been a student a generation earlier, as had Frederick Remington, and Rockwell was eager to will himself into their lineage. At the League, Rockwell found himself among teachers and art students who provided him with his first taste of New York bohemia. Everyone, it seemed, espoused radical politics and read poetry and had seen the latest issue of Mother Earth, Emma Goldman's anarchist magazine. This isn't to imply that Rockwell became a teenage bohemian. At 17, he was one of the youngest students at the League, just out of high school and inexperienced in the ways of the world. Most of his classmates were in their 20s and living on their own. They came to the League not only to study art, but for the privilege of being young and penniless in New York. Rockwell, by contrast, was still living with his parents in sleepy Mamaroneck and commuting to the city by train.
On Fridays, he would diligently lug home his portfolio and show his parents his latest figure studies. Against all reason, he hoped to impress them, to justify his presence at school. Unlike the National Academy of Design, the League charged tuition, $8 a month for each class, which was a sacrifice for his family. Among his classmates, he quickly became known as an exceptional draftsman, if a somewhat awkward presence. At this point, he had curly hair and was so gangly he appeared to be taller than he was. He stood just under 5'11". He concentrated on his work with a single-mindedness that earned him the nickname the Deacon. Women were among the students at the League, but he wasn't friendly with anyone in particular. By his own admission, he was surprised by the work habits of his fellow students, so many of whom seemed capricious, even reckless, working when the whim took them, even in the middle of the night. Rockwell, by contrast, would never work through the night, and he would never miss lunch. He was aware he was different from the other students, perhaps more ambitious or just more inhibited, and he felt excluded from the camaraderie of school life. The third-floor lunchroom was the League hangout, and throughout the day, students and teachers, along with art class models who'd tossed on bathrobes, conversed over coffee and cigarettes. Once, Rockwell was taken aback when a stylish art student with longish hair visible beneath a wide-rimmed hat accosted him in the lunchroom and remarked unkindly, "You know, if I worked as hard as you, I could be as good as Velázquez." Rockwell replied, "So why don't you?" In truth, he was bothered by his punch-the-clock work habits and wondered if his regular hours suggested some flaw in his nature. He once read somewhere that Sir John Everett Millais, the pre-Raphaelite painter, had swooned when he first saw the Mona Lisa. Rockwell later joked that he would go up to the Metropolitan Museum, stand in front of a Rembrandt he loved, and order himself, "Swoon, damn you, swoon." The League offered two courses in illustration and composition, and on his first day of school, Rockwell signed up for both of them. But the nuts and bolts of illustration turned out to be less compelling than he'd anticipated. A few weeks later, he dropped Ernest Blumenschein's illustration course and signed up instead for Life Drawing for Men, which was taught by George Bridgman, the most celebrated teacher at the League, and certainly the one who was to have the largest influence on Rockwell. Bridgman was then in his 40s, a short, stocky, cigar-smoking aesthete who swore liberally. His class met every afternoon from 1 o'clock to 4:30 and was limited to male students. Women had their own life-drawing class in order to be spared the impropriety of viewing an unclothed model in mixed company. The classes always began on time, and Rockwell was predictably punctual, rushing to retrieve his supplies, his charcoal and scrapers and Michelet drawing paper, from his locker, and then joining his classmates as they took their places on hardwood chairs arrayed in three long rows in front of the model, who was elevated on a platform. Rockwell, like the other men in the class, showed up in a button-down white shirt and a vest. No smock. The mood in Bridgman's class was hardly relaxed. Too many young men, sometimes as many as 40, were crowded into the airless studio, all of them sketching the same model. Every Friday afternoon, Bridgman ranked the students and their drawings. Each young man desperately wanted to be number one, to be confirmed in his belief that art was his obvious destiny. Each student sought to produce what his teacher called, with more than a little vanity, a number one Bridgman drawing, as if that represented a new plateau of human achievement. In reality, a Bridgman drawing was pretty much like the standard academic drawing of that era, or really of any era. For centuries, figure drawing had been the foundation of art education, and its fundamentals were essentially the same. Bridgman, as much as Thomas Aikens in the 19th century or Leonardo in the 16th, approached the human body as a feat of engineering, stressing its mechanics and basic dynamics instead of surface modeling. For students, the goal was to capture not merely the curve of a torso or a thigh, but to understand the muscles and bones that lay beneath it and gave the body its shape, to become acquainted with the tibia and the ulna and the femur and the humerus, a roster of Latinate words that had to be memorized. Bridgman wrote many manuals for artists, one of which was devoted exclusively to the human hand. From one week to the next, Rockwell was able to produce a number one Bridgman drawing, a technically polished, if emotionally void, figure study, one whose separate elements he had painstakingly executed over 4 or 5 days at a specified rate of progress. Even so, Rockwell was a nervous artist. His success at drawing never struck him as guaranteed. Each new figure study posed its own risk, opened up the possibility of getting everything wrong. Besides, Bridgman was as tough with him as with anyone else. The teacher didn't hesitate to correct directly on the student's work, redrawing an awkwardly pitched shoulder or a badly proportioned leg. Once Rockwell showed him what appeared to be an adequate study, only to hear, "You haven't got the main line of action. Look here, down through the hip." And then the teacher demonstrated, drawing a heavy black line down the middle of the figure. Rockwell spent the next day trying to erase Bridgman's corrections so his parents wouldn't think he was failing at school. Over the years, many artists have described their astonishment at first sketching a female nude, the rush of pleasure and embarrassment, the intense awkwardness pervading the studio as a group of young men shyly looked and lost their visual virginity en masse, their cheeks blushing, their hands trembling. Inevitably, they botched their first drawings. "His face was redder than it had ever been before in his life," the artist Guy Pendubois wrote of himself in the third person. Rockwell, however, treated the subject with curious remove. He later claimed that he and his classmates were so engrossed by the demands of drawing that "we just didn't think of the model as a woman." The comment might sound like a prudish feint, so much defensive posturing. But Rockwell probably spoke with some truth, if not for his classmates, then for himself. He found it more interesting to draw a model named Antonio Corsi, who was known to have posed for Sargent and Whistler. "His dark-skinned body was lithe, strong, and supple, wonderful to draw," Rockwell recalled. Tense as he was about the female body, he was less guarded about acknowledging the beauty of the male body. In the end, what Rockwell took away from Bridgman probably had less to do with the human figure and the bones running through it than the romance of his chosen field. Bridgman, the least snobby of aesthetes, revered the heroes of the golden age of illustration. After class was over, he would linger and talk to a few students and never seemed to be in a rush to ride the train home up to Pelham. He would reminisce about Howard Pyle and Edwin Austin Abbey while sipping on a beer and sketching distractedly on a scrap of paper.
Rockwell wanted to believe that illustration was a noble calling. And in Bridgman's company, he did believe it, believed that illustrators were the equal of fine artists. True, they committed the mercenary sin of earning money. But they did something socially valuable and uplifting. They recorded scenes from American history and literary classics. But the golden age of illustration, of which they aspired to be part, was already nearing extinction. An entire generation seemed to disappear while Rockwell was in school. Frederick Remington, who had immortalized the Wild West in his magazine illustrations, died in 1909 in Ridgefield, Connecticut. Winslow Homer, an undisputed master who had begun his career as a painter-journalist covering the Civil War for Harper's Weekly, died in his studio in Prout's Neck, Maine in 1910. John Lafarge wrote an obituary for Homer and expired 6 weeks later in Newport, Rhode Island. The following summer, Edwin Austin Abbey, a native Philadelphian known for his elegant line drawings of scenes culled from Shakespeare, troubadours, and the stage, died in London. But the death that registered the most sharply at the League was surely that of Howard Pyle, Rockwell's personal favorite. On November 9, 1911, just a month after Rockwell started school, Pyle died suddenly at the age of 58 from a kidney infection. He'd been living in a villa outside of Florence, studying mural painting, haunted by a sense that a lifetime's worth of illustration wasn't enough to guarantee his place as an artist. It wasn't just the loss of prodigiously gifted artists that was draining illustration of its early luster. It was also the rise of advertising. What had begun in America in the late 19th century as a cerebral populism, beautiful illustrations in books and literary magazines made possible by advances in photomechanical reproduction, by now had devolved into an exercise in hard-sell consumerism. Magazines were growing thick with advertisements for bicycles and upright pianos, for Knox gelatin and Pears soap. Illustrators who had dreamed in their youth of providing elegant etchings for books by Dickens or Shakespeare instead found themselves trying to draw a Swift's premium ham and persuade the public of its tastiness. As a student, Rockwell resolved to avoid the coarser outskirts of his field. In art school, he noted, the illustration class was just as highly respected as the portrait or landscape classes. Art Young, Charlie Kuntz, and I signed our names in blood, swearing never to prostitute our art, never to do advertising jobs, never to make more than $50 a week. He was referring to his illustration class with Thomas Fogarty, which met on weekdays from 8:30 to 12:30. Fogarty was the opposite of Bridgman, neat, tiny, nervous, and literal-minded, a professional illustrator, the son of Irish immigrants. He pointed his students straight to the marketplace. His own pen and ink illustrations appeared regularly in books published by Doubleday, Page, and other leading houses, and he generously shared his contacts with his students, encouraging them to search out assignments for themselves and start building relationships with art editors and book publishers. In class, he trumpeted one message: pictures are the servants of text. He gave his students hypothetical magazine assignments. They read short stories and poetry and picked out lines or verses to illustrate, preferably ones that exuded a bit of drama, that portrayed characters who might be dueling or reveling or sobbing into a handkerchief.
The drawings would be judged and graded as much for their artistry as for their fidelity to the text. The goal was to italicize.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.